So today in engine geology video lecture we will be learning unconformities, earthquake, GIS and GPS systems. So we will start with unconformities. What are unconformities? These are when sedimentary rocks are formed continuously one after the other, then the layers are called conformable beds or conformable sequence. So when the bedding layers which are formed in the nature, if they form layer by layer, then they are, and if those are in sequence, then they are called as conformable sequence or conformable beds, and that process altogether known as conformity, or that phenomenon known as conformity. For example, if it is a bed, it's the first and second bed, and it formed in 2006 and it is in 2007. So these two beds formed in sequence. That's why they are known as they are in conformable sequence. When these beds are formed not formed in the series, the given sequence of the years, then they are known as unconformable beds, or and the sequence is called as unconformable sequence. Now, types of unconformities. There are four major types of unconformities. First is disconformity. In this conformity, the beds lying below and above the surface of erosion are almost parallel. So, if it is a bed, if this is a bed, and the bed lying below and above the surface of erosion, and if this surface happens to be erosion surface, then those two beds should be parallel to each other or almost parallel. That means there is no angular variation. Then they are known as disconformity type of unconformity. Now, if you are coming with non-conformity, this non-conformity indicates or deals with the contact between two different beds. And if these are the beds, and this is bed 1, bed 2, and first bed is of, let's say, igneous rock, another is sedimentary rock, then this kind of unconformity is known as non-conformity. Now, the third one is angular unconformity. The angular unconformity is a type of conformity or is a sequence below. The unconformity may be steeply inclined, folded and faulted. The sequence above the surface of unconformity represent the younger formation. For example, if these are the beds, and if this line is an unconformity plane or unconformity line, so below this faults may occur. So this is fault and these are folds. And above this there is a parallel bed, and these are younger and these are older. So these type of unconformities are known as angular unconformity. Now, the examples of disconformity, non-conformity, angular conformity, like you can see this, the folds, you can see the folds and all that beneath this parallel planes. This is unconformity. The clearly is this one of these parallel planes are there. So this layer is unconformal layer below which we have folds and on which we have parallel beds. Now, beside these conformities, there are two more major type of conformity. One is local, another is regional. So, in local conformity, if it is this conformity is in within 2 kilometer of area of a given site, then these are known as local unconformity. And when those unconformity which are within the area or range of 100 kilometer, then they are known as regional unconformities. Now the next is earthquake. And what is earthquake? Constitutes one of the worst natural hazards which often turn into disaster, causing widespread destruction and loss to human life. The effects of earthquake vary on the magnitude and intensity of the earthquake. And earthquakes occur every now and then all around the globe or world, except in some places where earthquake occur rarely. So, for example, in India, zone 2 is the safest zone in which there is a rare chance of occurrence of earthquake. The devastation of cities and towns is one of the effects of earthquake. So the main major effect is the devastation of the city, region, wherever it occurs. So what exactly the earthquake is? It is a sudden release of energy in earth crust that creates seismic waves. This is earth. Seismic activity of an area refers to the frequency, type and size of earthquake experienced over a period of time. So over a period of time, if there is a seismic activity of an area, refers to the frequency, the type of earthquake experienced over a period of time, then that particular area is like is it the frequency, the earthquake occurs the frequency that all comprises of the area seismic activity. The example is if you throw a stone in the pond, then these ripples will be there. Exactly same, if there is an earthquake at some place, then there will be a ripple effect like this, and the seismic waves will travel from that point, which will be focal point. The focus point, it will travel to the all around the area. So sudden disturbances in the earth crust may produce vibration. So these ripple effects based on vibration, and the same is when earthquake struck, vibration will take place in the place where earthquake is struck, and same ripple kind of effect will be there. So there are few point terms related to earthquake. First is focus, which also known as hypocentric focus, is a place where along the fault plane, place where fault happens is focus. Epicenter is the point directly above the focus is epicenter. Fault line is a line along on which fault has happened, and also the line of intersection between the earth surface. Fault plane is a plane are the cracks or sudden slips of the land. So, the plane along which it slips. Fault scarp is the topographic expression of faulting attributed to the place displacement of the land surface by the movement along the fault. So, along the fault, there is a movement of land which produces scarp. So, what are the causes of earthquake? The primary cause of earthquake is fault on the crust of the earth. So the primary causes of the earthquake is fault, with which the earthquake triggers. A fault is a break or fracture between two blocks. lumps of rocks in response to the stress. So in response to stress, the fracture or break happens, and that results in the earthquake. This movement may occur rapidly in the form of earthquake, or may occur slowly in the form of quake. So that fracture or fault will happen regularly and may occur slowly. And if it occurs slowly, maybe in the form of creep. Earth scientists use the angle of fault with respect to the surface, known as dip angle of fault, and the relation of slip along the fault to classify the fault. Which kind of fault is this? Like strike slip fault, dip slip fault, and there are many kinds of faults. So the major causes of earthquake are surface causes, volcanic causes, tectonic causes. What is surface causes? For example, great explosion, landslides, slips on steep coasts, dashing of sea waves, avalanches, railway trains, heavy trucks. Some large engineering projects cause minor tremors, some of them man-made or other, or like detonating the mines, the regular detonation of mine in order to draw the natural resources, for example marble mines and coal mines. What can be the volcanic cause? Volcanic eruptions produce earthquakes. Earthquakes may precede, accompany, and frequently follow the volcanic eruptions. So when there is a volcanic eruption, there will be a sudden pressure from the inside, the liquid portion, which is known as magma, and that will create the fractures along the length and breadth of the soil, and that in turn produces the volcano. Then that magma will go through the will follow a channel, and that channel will lead to the volcanic places where magma can blast out and come in the form of lava, and the fracture produced by it triggers the earthquake in that region. So what can be the tectonic cause? Structural disturbances resulting in the parts of lithosphere is the main cause of this type of earthquake. So we all know the tectonic plates are plates. There are 12 into 2 types of major plates. In that, 6 are the major and other 6 remaining are the minor. The 6 are which differentiate between the continents. Most of the disasters actually belong to this category, because tectonic, on which the whole crust of earth is resting, and if tectonics plate collide each other or just strike each other, then there will be the release of energy that will be converted into earthquake. So these are the waves produced by the earthquake. Seismic waves produced due to earthquake are basically divided into two major types. One is body waves, another is surface waves. Body waves, which travel through the body of the object, and the surface waves, which travel through the surface. The examples of body waves are primary and secondary. The examples of surface waves are Love waves and Rayleigh waves. So these are the P waves, or primary waves, or the types of any type of body waves which travel. This is primary, which travel almost on the parallel waves, and surface waves which travel through the secondary wave, which travel through the in transverse direction. Let's say if they are traveling in longitudinal direction, they will travel into transverse direction. And surface waves travel on the surface, on just some given depth on the surface, maybe. So if we want to differentiate between the primary waves, secondary waves, this primary is longitudinal, secondary is transverse. This primary can pass through the solids and liquids, and can, but this secondary cannot move through the liquids. Primary waves move forwards and backwards, so it compresses and decompresses, and secondary waves moves in all directions. P waves is faster than S waves, and first when earthquake strikes, P PA will be arrive first and then behind S wave will arrive. Surface waves travel parallel to the earth crust and these are the most damaging because everything created structure all are related to the earth crust only. That's why it's the most damaging wave. Now, the type of surface wave, Love waves and Rayleigh waves. So, the Rayleigh wave is like it will travel in like a circle and it will create the ripple in the longitudinal direction. But in Love wave, it will produce in almost transverse to the Rayleigh. So, it will produce this kind of effect and Rayleigh will produce this kind of effect. So, you can just compare the Love waves with primary waves of body in body wave and Rayleigh waves in secondary of secondary waves. So you can just the differentiate between these and you can find the similarities between Love waves and primary waves, Rayleigh waves and secondary waves. So if you want to differentiate between Love waves and Rayleigh waves, these both are guided waves. Love wave displacement is parallel to the free surface and displacement of Rayleigh waves is compared to the Love wave. Love wave is faster, Rayleigh is slower. Causes horizontal shifting of the earth surface and Rayleigh is ground moving circular motion. So Rayleigh wave ground moving circular motion. So how we assess the strength of the earthquake? The measurement of earthquake's energy is transferred or is being converted into the Richter scale. So if we know the value of Richter scale, we can quantify the energy produced in that particular Richter scale number. So we just record the strength of the earthquake on Richter scale with the help of seismograph. So seismograph just depicts the graph. I will show you the graph. So this is seismograph and this seismograph shows the fault or the vibration or the typical waves which were produced and their intensity. And that will be converted into the magnitude of Richter scale with the group according to the number of the magnitude. So if the Richter scale is 8, for example, the earthquake struck of Richter scale 8 or higher, then it will be the great, then it will release the great energy and the destruction will be great, much more. And if it is 7.9, the earthquake is of major category and the destruction will be major. And if it is 6.6 to 6.9, then it will be a strong earthquake. So these are the earthquake categories with respect to the Richter scale. So now, as I said, the intensity of the Richter scale is converted into the energy. So these are the energy released in, as per the Richter scale. So this is the instrument seismometer with the help of seismometer we record or we measure the earthquake. So seismometers are the instrument that measure motions of the ground, including those of seismic waves generated by earthquakes, volcanic eruptions and other seismic sources. Seismometers may be deployed at earth surface, in shallow vaults, in boreholes or under water. So it can be installed there. But as far as current research is concerned, seismometers shows the or measures the earthquake, but still human species not able to find out the just not able to profess the arrival of the earthquake. Like we can profess the arrival of weathering patterns, we can profess the arrival of or forecast the arrival or forecast the hitting of tsunami. We can do all these things, but still human species is unable to find out how to forecast the earthquake. So these are the various zones in which this earthquake is been divided as per the Indian Code Standard zone 2. Now zone 1 is being merged in zone 2, that's why zone 2 is said to be the least active seismic zone. Zone 3 is included the moderate seismic zone, zone 4 is going to be the high seismic zone, and zone 5 is the highest seismic zone. So these are the zones according in Indian map, and you can see zone 1 where we are right now, it falls under zone 1, or let's say zone 1 or zone maybe here somewhere, so zone 1 or zone 2, whichever you see. So how to predict an earthquake? There are some evidence of upcoming earthquake is coming. Unusual animal behavior. Animals have a capacity to sense the natural disasters, so they can sense the behavior. We can just say if we have to predict the earthquake, we have to sense the unusual animal behavior. Water level in wells, large scale of fluctuations of oil from oil wells, four shocks or minor shocks before major earthquake, temperature change, uplifting of earth surface, change in seismic wave velocity. So we can, with these evidences, we can predict that earthquake will come, when it will come, or it has struck, whatever. So these are the effects of earthquake: life loss, the major effect, human population life loss and property, damage to transportation, damage to infrastructure, chances of flood, chances of fire, short circuit, communication disruption, water pipes and sewage disruption, economic activities like agriculture disruption, and everything will be affected severely. So these are the examples: effects, landslide, shaking of ground. Now fires, soil liquefaction, tsunami, floods. Now what are the safety rules when earthquake has just struck? One, if you are in house, don't use lift or getting down from the building. And these are the various safety rules which you have to follow when the earthquake has struck. Now, these are the earthquake which has already struck or occurred in India in the chronological order. India and nearby places in India like Muzaffarabad in Pakistan, occupied Kashmir, which is PUK. So in Jhansar in Pakistan, occupied Kashmir, the earthquake has struck, which has damaged heavily life property. So these are the very different earthquake which has struck in chronological order and the damages done by the earthquake. So these are the few pictures of the earthquakes in the same chronological order. And these are the major earthquakes of the world, which is all around the world. Now the next topic is GPS, Global Positioning System. So what is GPS? It is a global positioning system. It is a system to identify the position on globe. So wherever you are in globe, this GPS helps you to position you, that where are you on the globe exactly. It is aided by a network of satellites. So we launch satellites for GPS purpose, so that a particular subject which we are looking can be located. So this GPS has three segments: space segment, control segment, and user segment. This is space segment, like satellites, for example, the satellite part. Control system is the place where you can control the incoming and outgoing of the signals. And user segment is what we receive on our system, on our device, GPS device. This is user segment. So what does space segment consist? Consists of 24 satellites in 6 orbits. Each satellite transmits low power radio signals. six orbital planes ensure at least four or more satellites available at almost all time. So when you are positioning a particular subject, at least there should be four satellites available, or it can be more, but at least four should be available to locate a particular subject. Now in control segment, a master control station should be there where you can send the signals and receive the signals from the satellite. Unmanned monitor station should be there where you can monitor the satellites. And large ground antenna stations where you can receive, through antenna you can receive the signals and send the instructions to the satellite. So these are the various global positioning system and master control stations network all around. Now the user segment. In user segment, military and civilians use GPS. Civilians mainly use GPS to find out the in an unknown territory. You have to find out if we are in unknown territory, we can find out the exact location where we are and the destination we have to reach. It can locate the distance between you and your destination and the path also, so that you can follow that path and reach to your destination. And for military, they can use military for their military purposes and for locating the enemy's bunkers and all these things. Military can use that. The GPS receivers, which we use for receiving as a user segment, decode the signal from satellite, which is sent by satellite, and calculate the distance. So it calculates the distance, how much we are. Means where is our destination, so it will calculate the distance between that and the path also. Now how the GPS works. All satellites have clocks set to exactly same time. All satellites know their exact position from data sent to them from the system controllers. Each satellite transmits its position and a time signal. The signals travel to the receiver delayed by distance travel. The difference in distance travel make each satellite appear to have different time, and the receiver will read the distance of each satellite and can then calculate the its own position. So this is how a GPS work device works, or GPS process works. So for example, suppose the distance from satellite A is our position is 11,000 miles. From A we are at 11,000 miles. At this point, we could be located anywhere on the specified sphere. Now, next, let us take another measurement from satellite B. So, when we are in the range of satellite A, it can locate this us in a sphere. But when a second satellite comes, it will further narrow down our search and it will say this particular subject is in this area. Is a given, well-defined given circle or whatever be the sphere. So it will just the subject, if it is subject and there are two satellites, so it will be like narrow down further search to this will be your next second satellite, and if it is a third satellite, then further it will narrow down to this one where we can search like this. So now the person is in this, and if it is a fourth, then it will further. So now we are in this range. So this is how satellites work and locate our position. Now there are few errors or source of errors. One is multipath error, another is PDOP, and third is SNR. SNR is sound loss ratio, and it is precise dilution of position, dilution of precision. So what is multipath error? When GPS signals arrive at the receiver having traveled from different path, I will show the how it is happening. So if we have sent some signal, it will arrive to us back from the satellite from different paths. So there can be error in that. Second, position dilution of precision. So like consider this POP as an umbrella, and we are here. Subject is here. Now, if the satellite directly orbits us, one can be here, one can be here, or another can be here somewhere. So it will locate us like this. So this kind of subject location is good POP, a good position illusion of precision. But when that will be poor, it will be like it is having very less circumference area, and this one have more circumference area. So the location will be very good in this case. So we have to take example. We have to consider like it's like an umbrella. So the more will be the circumference of the umbrella, the more will be protected from the rain. Exactly same can be applied to the PDOP. The more will be the circumference, the good will be the PDOP. Now next is signal to noise ratio. So signal to noise ratio. So if like we can see from here only, that if signal is let's say constant, we have constant signal and the noise is more, the ratio will be less, and the ratio will be less, then there will be more disturbance, there will be more error. And if there is sitting a constant signal and noise will be less, the overall ratio will be more and the error will be less. So SNR determines the signal strength related to the noise. So if we are receiving a signal with less noise, it will be more audible. And if we are receiving signal with more noise, it will be less audible. Therefore, it will be having some error. And that error is shown by this strength to noise ratio. Now, what are the uses of GPS? First is navigation, of course. We can also use for mapping. And this can be used for military operations for high precision. Now, next is GIS. Geographical Information System. A technology, what is GIS? A technology, hardware and software tools. We have having hardware and software tools to know the geographical area, the information about geographical area, and information handling strategy. The objective is to improve the overall decision making. This is all about GIS. Now, what is the definition of GIS? A system for capturing, storing, checking, integrating, manipulating, analyzing, and displaying data which are spatially referenced to the Earth, like geographical reference to the Earth. This is normally considered to involve a spatially referenced computer database and appropriate application software. So these are the software GIS. Now, what is the history of this GIS? Maps have been used for portraying information in Earth's surface from olden time, like land survey, navigation, military purposes. First, Europeans have started producing the general maps for their boundary location, administrative controls, and all this thing, and topography. Then, that maps again is being improvised, and then again having different features like soil, land, geology, the contours, and all these things. Different topographical maps, and then essentially we are able to create the mapping of the even the resources, the natural resources. So this is how the GIS has evolved. Maps were produced on papers and films earlier, but now we can produce maps on the digital devices we have. We can use the map, and even we can rectify it, we can improve it by using the technology available. Now, what is GIS process? First, it captures data, register the map base, interpret the data, convert data to digital format, store data in computer, process the data and then display the result. This is the flowchart how GIS process works. This is the one kind of geological. First of all, it will go to the above layer if we are searching in a spatial area of the earth. Then it will go down, estimate the aerial photo, then again the pH layer, all these things will estimate in a given map area. So it's like drilling down approach, data layers by layer. So the GIS process follows the data layer by layer process and it is having drilling down approach. Now we have data formats of GIS and that are raster and vector form. What is raster? Raster divides into cell pixels or elements. Cells are organized in arrays. Each cell has a signal value. Row and column numbers are used to identify the location of the cell within the array. Perhaps the most common example of raster data is a digital image. So digital image is a kind of raster format. What about vector format? Vector format, the data are associated with points, lines or boundaries enclosing the areas. Points are located by coordinates. Lines are described by a series of connecting vectors line. Areas or polygons are described by a series of vectors enclosing the area. Now, in vector format, any number of vectors or attributes can be associated with the point, line or polygon. Data are stored in two files, a file containing location information and a file containing information of the attributes. The third file contains the information needed to link positional data with their attributes. So we can also see the positional data on their attributes. If we have to see the graphical representation of the vector and the raster representation. This is the map feature in line. Now this is the GIS vector format. We will see the vector is the direction format. And this is the GIS raster format. We have each cell divided and each cell has a signal value. If it is a map feature, this is the original map feature. This is the GIS representation format of that map feature. And this is the raster representation of that format, map format. The spatial data stored by the vector model is like this, as geometric objects, point and polygons, and the raster model is image. So raster model is all about the images. Now the comparison between raster and vector. Raster formats are efficient, vector formats are efficient when comparing information whose geometrical shapes and size are different. Raster files are generally very large because each cell provides a separate line and data and all. Vector files are much smaller because the relatively small number of vectors can precisely describe the large area. So it is less, it occupies less space. In raster representations are relatively coarse and imprecise. Vector representation of shapes can be very precise because it shows the direction also. Most GIS software can display both raster and vector data. Only a limited number of programs can analyze both types of data or make raster type analysis in vector formats. So this is how the vector and raster format develops. Now, where GIS can be used in interdisciplinary places? We can use in remote sensing, surveying, photogrammetry, digital mapping, computer aided design, CAD, CAD and databases. Now, how to interpolate the algorithms? We can interpolate the algorithms in two different ways, nearest neighbor and local averaging. How we do in nearest neighbor? Nearest neighbor is the value of nearest measurement to the missing data. If, for example, this is the missing data, we can see the nearest neighbor and we can use the data. We can take the average of the nearest neighbor data and we can find out the missing data. In local average of all values within a predetermined distance. So we have defined the distance. In that distance, we will take the values of each of the area, and that will be averaged, and that will be the missing data of the place where we are not having the data of that place, or missing data. So this is all about GIS, GPS, and the unconformities.